y'all. Welcome back to another episode of Texas Underground. I am your host, Jay Vass. And as always, make sure you follow us on all the social media pages at The Jay Vass Show. And as always, this show is brought to you by La Conecta. Make sure you check them out at shoplaconecta.com. They got the air fresheners. They got the cut energy drink by Candice Al Cien. The Mamalona de Cut. This book's been going around Twitter. They got hats and all kinds of other cool stuff. This show is also brought to you by GT Digital Distribution. If you're an independent artist looking to take your music to the next level, make sure you guys check them out at gtdigitaldistribution.com. It's also brought to you by Tatted Locals. I don't know if you can see this, but I just got a tattoo right now a couple hours ago. So make sure you guys check them out. We'll put the address right here. And, man, let's jump right into it. This show is sponsored by friends of the show. You're going to see them on camera right quick. This show is brought to you by Hustletown Network, Hustletown Certified. Joining me today, a special guest is going to be helping us with this interview. Tex, the infamous Tex, to be exact.
That's right, man. That's a hell of an intro right there, man. Shout out to Jay Vass right here in the building, man. My brother from another, man. It's all love. Again, shout out to everybody right here. He just named, you know, GT Digital, we in the house, man. And Jay Vass, I appreciate you having me on, man.
Man, it's gonna be a dope interview, bro. I appreciate you, you know, helping us out put this interview together, and you know, you're about to help me jump into it as well. And I know y'all been waiting for it, so we're gonna take you right into it, man. We're gonna get on the phone with the Mexican land legend himself, Lil Bing. So make sure you guys stay tuned and hit the like button, hit the subscribe button, and let's jump into it, Tex. Joining us now, the Texas land legend, the Mexican land legend himself. He's not Nelly and he's not Diddy, but your girl want to get with him. Lil Bing in the house. What's going on, Bing? Already, bro. Hey, man, it's an honor to have you on here, bro. It's an honor to have you on the line. And we're going to jump right into the interview, bro. And we got some of the Instagram followers and the social media followers to help us with this interview, just because we wanted to see what they wanted to know. So some of these questions come directly from your fans. And we're going to jump right into it, bro. Being that you were so young, man, and on fire when you were doing your thing out here, what was it like being guided by legends in the game like Fileto and Ike, man?
Oh, man. They taught me a lot.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just being around them, you know, just the whole aggravated, man. Graham, Shadow, Loco, Big D. Just being around that whole atmosphere, man, getting on stage, just seeing them boys, because I used to get on stage with them supporting their music before I was even an artist. So I was getting that experience, man. And I was real young at the time. I was like, what, 12, 13 years old, you know, hanging out late night with these dudes. So, man, they kind of groomed me in that aspect. But I really wasn't trying to be no rapper. I was just around them, just liking it. So it didn't come about. I went to TYC. So the whole time in TYC, I used to just freestyle. That's all I did in there, just playing around. I wasn't taking it serious, just, you know, passing time. And when I got out of TYC, they were signed with Jam Down, the commission. They were signed with Jam Down Records. And that's where Lil TC was at. So on one particular day, I was riding with my cousin Ike, man, and they were getting ready to go drop something at the studio. And I was just playing around with Ike, and I told him, well, I can rap. And he was like, well, let me hear something. So he was like, I was just playing around freestyling. And he was like, man, yo, you can rap for real. So they went to the studio, and I wasn't even thinking about that I was gonna, you know, be on a song that day. They put me in the booth, man, and I went in there. I ran it like nothing, real quick. I got paid $100 to jump on the compilation, man. My first time ever in a vocal booth, and that was the beginning, right there, man. Just being around the same two names you said, Ike, man, and Fileto.
Hey, what was that first song, brother? The first time, do you remember just going back in there into that studio? What was the very first song? Was it just freestyle or?
I wrote it so fast, but I think it was called We the Ones, and it was on a compilation with a bunch of people. I think it's a bunch of local artists on there too. But yeah, that was my first time in the vocal booth, getting that experience.
When the ones.
I was fresh out of CYC.
Yeah. Hey, man, let me ask you this, bro. Being that you just said you didn't even want to be a rapper, taking that into consideration, and then the fact that you've been gone for so long, how does it feel knowing you have such a strong following out here still, even after all these years?
Man, it's mind-blowing. It's amazing, bro. I just, believe it or not, man, sometimes, man, it's things like that to keep me grounded in here when, you know, I times make it hard and I may be dealing with some conflict within myself. Man, it's my fans, bro. Hey, they relentless, man. They show a lot of love, bro. They're down for me, bro. I ain't gonna lie. So, man, it's love, bro. I love it, man. I appreciate it.
Man, and you know, one of the tracks that, for example, this weekend, I was at the house chilling, and my little 16-year-old nephew's there. They're in the other room jamming the music, and they played it like three times, the House Party Freestyle. And it's crazy because I was their age when this song came out. So now listening to them listen to it, it's like, bro, this is so dope. So let me ask you this. Being that the House Party became so popular, what's your reflection on that track now?
My reflection on that track, man, is I never expected it to do what it did. I mean, it was a freestyle, right? We were just playing around with words. So the impact that it had, man, is crazy because a lot of people identify me with that one track. And it's more my fans, you know, giving my second name, the Mexican Latin Legend, just because I freestyled that on that song. So now everybody calls me Bing the Latin Legend, or Bing the Mexican Latin Legend. So I guess it's a second nickname that my fans awarded me because of that song.
Yeah.
And I've got letters from fans in here that tell me, man, you know, my boy died, man, and you were his favorite rapper, man, and he played your song House Party at the funeral. So, you know, it's things like that touch me, bro. So, man, that song. And then, you know, I've had other people tell me, well, you know, we just had a baby, man, and my baby goes to sleep listening to the House Party, man, when we're in the car, we play it. And, you know, it's just little stuff like that, man, that just makes you think about that song and all the, you know, the impact.
Yeah. Personally, do you feel like is there any other song you feel should have gotten the same exposure?
Can you repeat that?
Oh, I said, personally, do you feel like there was any other song that should have gotten the same exposure?
I'm gonna be honest, man. Coming up, rapping, I never expected to get the exposure that I got. I wasn't really trying to be no rapper. I wasn't trying to make no career out of it. I was just having fun with, you know, going on tour with my friends, you know, family members. We were just kicking it. So it was just, to me, it was more like I don't even want to say like a hobby. It was just something that I did just to play around and, you know, have fun and be able to go out of town and, you know, do things with my boys out of town, you know, keeping it with them and being on stage, partying, you know, that type of stuff. So I never really took it serious. I never really just sat down and been like, you know what, I'm going to make a hit song or I'm going to do this. It was just like, hey, Ben, you want to get on this? Yeah, I'll get on it. Boom, I'll write it down real quick. Everybody will tell you, and I'll stand out. There was no sitting down, taking my time with an actual song. Everything was just done real quick, in and out. So I never really expected the exposure that I got. It was just crazy that I did get it. I always trip out on that. And I remember the first time I saw it, I was on East in Galveston, and they had just dropped that Houston Volume 3 with Stuck in the Mud. And we had parts. And when we parked, damn near every car that was passing by, it was jamming my songs, or one of my songs that was on the Houston Body 3. And my cousin was with me, and he was just like, brother, jamming me, you know what I'm saying? Hey, how you feel? You know, and I just remember just being just like stuck in the day, like, it didn't really hit me. I was like, because I wasn't expecting that. That wasn't my goal.
Yeah.
Man, and that's still one of the hardest albums out there, especially with from Dope House too. That was one of the top selling albums that they, you know, they put out also. Jay Vaz, we were talking about something right before this. As far as you working with Carlos too, because I know y'all did shared a lot of stage sometimes. You know, you would open up, would shut him down. You mentioned also doing stuff with Dope House also, you know, performing multiple times on stage. Vaz, ask that question that you asked me a while ago.
Yeah, so one of the questions was, considering, you know, the hype you had and how Dope House was taking off, if you hadn't got locked up and the opportunity presented itself, would you have ever considered signing with Dope House?
I would have signed with Dope House if they were talking the right numbers, because obviously everything is at the time, though, I didn't understand the business aspect, so I didn't know about all that, you know, getting your money and, you know, what you're worth. I was just jumping on stuff and say, you got a check for me, I'm signing it. I wasn't worried about what rights I was signing away, nothing. So, yeah, I would have had to be right. I would have. I think I probably would have gotten offered, you know, opportunities with Dope House, but they probably looked at me as a liability because the way I was living, I was just too much in the street, so nobody wants to invest their money into somebody who's out there, you know, you're thugging, you're packing guns, you know, you're subject to get locked up any day. Who wants to invest money into that? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I'm just being brutal and be honest with myself. I think that's what it was.
Yeah, I got you. Speaking of projects, bro, I know, you know, for the longest there was promotion going on for the Pound for Pound album with you and Villain. How much of that project got done?
Well, a lot of that project got put on the Scoosin' Volume 3. So a lot of those songs that you hear on there were songs that, you know, me and Villain were putting together for that album. But Shut 'Em Down had a, I guess they decided to make a deal with Dope House, and they just scraped up whatever albums they had and Shut 'Em Down, which was basically all our songs, and they put it on the Scoosin' Volume 3.
Yeah.
I was pretty upset about that at first, but, you know, it is what it is. But, you know, everybody's trying to get their money, so I understand.
Man, and that Pound for Pound right there, man. I mean, I can only imagine what the studio session was like, right? If there was a dramatization of you know, that project, you know, just being put together, you know, you guys in the studio, what would you say that if you had to describe the studio session, man, just the vibes when y'all were in there and recording these songs, what was some of them studio sessions like?
Man, the studio sessions was like a trap house, bro. It was straight thugged out. Man, you go in there, you know, we firing up, we smoking blunts. You're gonna have the homies there. You're gonna have some females pull up. Sometimes, you know, we're having parties, but, you know, we're buying beer, we're pulling all nighters. It was just, we just having fun, bro. And then a lot of those songs just came up out of nowhere. Like, it was like the Pound for Pound Freestyle. That was supposed to be an actual song. So me and Dylan did the hook. You know how the song starts? That's actually supposed to be a hook. But we did the hook, and I just freestyled, just playing around like I always do. And Leto had it on record, and they decided to keep it. So that's how that came about. It was actually supposed to be me and Dylan making the actual song, putting verses on, but it just turned into a freestyle that I did.
Man,
hey, let me ask you this though. As a fan, I've always wondered, is there any other unreleased tracks that we haven't heard yet? Have you been able to keep track of that hasn't been released?
I believe there's a couple of them that haven't been released. I don't know if they're ever going to get released. Some of them are kind of lost or in people's hands that I gotta, you know, figures, you know, you got to work out the business side of things. There is some tracks, though, that haven't been released, though.
Man, I know, you know, you put out a project. Obviously, you put out the project that were You had Lucky Luciano on it, perform all the tracks, and then you put out the Blessings and Curses project as well. Could we expect any new projects in the upcoming years?
Actually, I'm working on a project right now where I stand right now in my faith. So today, bro, I'm a Christian, bro. I stand out in the Christian community. You know, that's where I'm at. You know, I know what I did growing up. I know all the chaos I promoted and all that stuff. So me being a mature individual, I can look back and say that wasn't right because all the pain that was involved, and a lot of that pain was self-inflicted on myself as well. So, man, I had to change, bro. That's the bottom line. So you can expect some new music, and it will be faith-inspired, but it will be like a subtle faith-inspired, like with some raw emotions. Like, you're going to... It'll probably go harder than them street albums you hear out there. So
yeah,
it's definitely gonna be some new music. So it's gonna be a different hit this time. Yeah, I need something with this stuff.
We can respect that.
Right on, man. Hey, and you know, I got to hear a recent track that you did with Shadow for his Hustletown Underground album. Fire right there, man. And at the end of one of the tracks, you mentioned, you know, getting to rub shoulders with Screw and being, you know, there and chop it up with Screw, you know, just weeks before he passed. You know, we never got to get that Screw tape, man. That would have been cold, but had that happen, you know, I got to ask you, what do you think that for one, that Screw tape would have been like? And also, what would you have called that Screw tape? What do you think that one would have been right there, man? Because that would have been, that would have been the one we needed for the longest, brother.
Oh man, that's a good question. So when I was at the dope house, it was the Hustle Town. It was at SBN Club, right? So I wasn't expecting school to be there. I was just there that day, and he happened to pull up. So SBN was right there. We're in the middle of the club, and you know, SBN's whispering in his ear, introducing him to me, like, "Hey, this is Bing, whatever, guys," you know. And then, you know, we shook hands. You know, we talked about, hey, man, let's link up. And I'm pretty sure SBM had a bunch of projects lined up for Screw, too, because he had just got that deal. So I know SBM had a lot of projects lined up that would involve Screw. And I'm pretty sure I was part of a good amount of those projects, you know what I mean? So, man, I remember Screw, he had came with somebody, and the person he came with had a pipe. He had a pint of drink in his pocket. So they were sipping inside the club. And I kept trying to buy the dude's drink from him, but he wouldn't sell it. I was offering him outrageous numbers because in my mind, I thought it was going to be the coolest thing ever to say, I sipped some lean right here at the dope house with Screw. But that didn't happen because he didn't want to sell it. I was sure trying to buy a cup. what I would have named that song, that school tape, I probably would have named it something like Endo Park. Or in Grand Oak Park, that would have named it something cool like that, probably Endo Park.
Man,
Bing, I know you mentioned, being a Christian now, and you talked about reflecting on your past. Have you ever considered writing a book? Since we got to know so little of you being in the free world, have you ever considered about writing a book of your past and where you're at mentally now?
Actually, that's what I'm doing right now. I'm in I'm taking a creative writing class out of the University of Texas. So I'm a registered student at the UT under Professor Deb Olin Umford. She doesn't like to be called a professor, but that's what she is. You know what I mean? And she's known. She's real respected, man. In Texas, I think nationwide as well. She's got real good. Great books, they got awards and stuff. So, I am writing a book about myself, man, right now, and I'm tapping into that creative writing. That way I can, you know, try to write movie scripts and all that stuff. So that's what I'm doing right now. I write short stories, and at the same time, I am writing my book too.
Yeah. Man, and this is hypothetically speaking. Let's say you would have never got locked up, bro. What do you think would have happened as far as your career?
It's been a couple of things that have happened. I mean, I could have taken off. they said Robert Gilliman, who was over at Southwest Hotel back at that time, he had got a lot of money from Telemundo, and he was going back. He supposedly had got a couple of millions, and he was going back looking for some Latino talent, and he was coming to look for us. But I happened to be locked up at that time fighting this murder case. So that's one scenario. But I mean, I was on drugs, bro. I was heavy on Xanax. I was heavy on drink. I was smoking fry. I was in the gang life. So I mean, it's a chance, bro. I probably could have died in my 20s. I probably could have died of an overdose. I probably could have died through some gun violence. Being real.
Yeah.
So that ain't no telling, man. Things happen for a reason. Maybe this penitentiary saved me, or maybe I could have stayed out, and maybe I could have millions and changed my life. Maybe I could have had a kid, and that would have helped me change. You know, it could have been a number of, it could have been more than one thing that could have happened, man.
For sure. Hey, man, I know initially when you got locked up, they said there was no possibility of parole. Has that changed? Is there a possibility of parole now?
Yes, I see parole in 8 more years. I got a parole date. That's 2 more presidential terms. So you know how fast those presidential terms fly by. So
yeah.
I like to count them in 4 because, you know, they fly by pretty fast. So I got 2 more of those.
Nice. That's dope, man. Man, look, check this out, bro. So I started a series where I talk about people that I consider Texas land legends. Obviously, we have you on that list. And I wanted to ask you personally, who would you consider the top 5 Texas land legends?
Top 5? Me, I would consider, man, I'm going to go with, you know, Lucky and Low for sure. I'd probably say Bass. You know, Bass came up out of Texas, so that Baby Bass, you know, made a nice movement down here. He came to Texas and did his thing, man. So I would say Bass. I would probably say Flatline, and man, maybe GT Garden. I like that boy.
Man. Hey, are there some good spitters out there, even in the prison system? I'm sure you came across a couple of guys that can spit. You know, I know there's got to be the freestyle corner from time to time, man. You know, I know. Are there some people in there right now that you feel like some talent that we could have had out here in the free world that are in there right now?
Man, there's tons of talent in here, bro. I didn't cut across some people that are cold, both black and white. There's a lot of talent in here, man. Music-wise, art-wise, you know, electrical-wise, these dudes can make the radio do anything, man. There's a lot of talent.
So Bing, we know you've been keeping up with some of these artists out here. Is there any artist in mind that you have that, you know, 8 years come and go, bro? So whenever you're out here, do you have anything in mind who you would like to work with?
Man, I wouldn't mind working with the Mexican OG. You know, I've been hearing a lot of noise about him, man. He's actually been showing a lot of love. Just, you know, just keeping my name alive on his end.
Yeah.
You know, that's the best right there, you know. Just he's keeping it real as far as my influence on his music. So that's love. So I would love to work with him. And, you know, anybody out of Houston, man, I wouldn't mind working with them, man. There's no, I'm not going to cut myself off from anybody, man. But only thing I will say, if I'm going to do some music, man, it has to have a legit message with the customers, man. I don't want to do no music and we're talking about, you know, killing somebody, or we're talking about causing harm and doing all these drugs and stuff. If that's not the person I am today, you know what I mean? So I don't want to promote that type of stuff anymore.
Yeah.
Man. And I gotta ask also, so going back to, you know, the times when y'all were doing everything that y'all were doing out there, man, you know, y'all were making history almost without knowing that it was being history made, being made at the time. You know, because y'all were just living in the moment. You know what I'm saying? Everything from you, Carlos, Screw, you know, it just became a, you know, this big Texas. Y'all are almost the faces of Texas, basically. Y'all are, you know. So while y'all were out there, while you were out here just doing your thing with Shut Them Down, did you ever feel like it would get the way it is right now? Did you ever think at the time that, you know, the y'all were going to become the legends that you are just, you know, when you were doing this? Or was this just, you were just living day by day at the time?
Man, bro, we was just living day by day at the time. And that word legend came into my vocabulary when I got out of TYC, and I heard one of BG's songs, Cash Money. We got a song called Living Legend. And that song kind of had a little impact on, you know, on the idea of being a legend right there. And then later on, they dropped the album called The Legend. And that was just kind of like solidified that word that I was like, okay, The Legend, man. This is what it is right here. You know what I'm saying? And that's kind of what inspired me to even rap and House Party Flow. That's where that comes from. And I think a lot of times, man, we don't even know what we do, man. We speak stuff into existence. And we can speak negative into existence, and you can speak positive into existence. You know, the power of the tongue is a strong thing. So I try to, you know, keep positive stuff in my mouth now, man. Because I ain't trying to put any curses upon myself. I done shot myself in the foot too many times. I don't even know how I'm walking. But yeah, man, that's what that is, like this, right?
Okay. And another name we hear a lot in the Houston rap scene, but to those who weren't around at the time may have not known the person or not known who he was, you know, to contributing to the Latin game, D-Town. You know, we hear the name D-Town all the time, you know, affiliated with, you know, Shut Him Down and all that too. Can you explain to us, you know, who D-Town was to you, brother? I mean, I know y'all had relationship with each other as far as, you know, you know, him being down with you and you down with Shut Him Down. Explain to us, you know, who D-Town was to you, man, because I know we lost him a while back, but go ahead and explain to us, you know, to those who don't know or are familiar with him.
D-Town was a big baller, man. D-Town had that bread, man. He was a D-boy, man. He was a club. So, man, that was my boy, man. He was like a big homie, man. You know, he was from Denver Harbor. You know, we were from South East. So, you know, the studio was in Denver Harbor. So, just by having D-Town and us going over there, it kind of like, there used to be a beef between South East and D-Mex, you know, because they were red, we were blue. But I believe, man, when Shut Them Down came about, he broke that. That flex, man, like all that kind of died out, man, and it was just about making money, man, making this music, man, and doing it. So that's what I could say D-Town did, man, the positive that he did, man, that he brought two neighborhoods together to put that beat to the side and to focus on, you know, focus on the music, man, and making things happen.
That's right, man. And what a time it was too, man. You know, even the house party days, you know, that's what, you know, what we're out here doing right now, you know, Hustle Town Network, you know, you got J-Vaz, you got GT Digital, you got a bunch of platforms that are trying to continue, you know, the legacy that a lot of you guys created, you know, and there's a home for that now that we really haven't had in a very long time since the, you know, the Party 104.9 days and all that. So, you know, we salute you and, you know, everything you've done. You know, still being the man from where you're at right now. And, you know, we definitely can't wait to meet you and work with you too, man. When you do come home, you know, we keep these podcasts, we put these podcasts out so we can connect with your listeners and the fan base. So, you know, is there any other stuff, anything else you want to tell the listeners out there, the supporters of Lil Bing and Shut Them Down, man? Anything you want to go ahead and tell them?
Oh, man, I want to share one last memory, man, before I get this shout out, man. I remember we opened up with Big Pokey one time. Big Pokey had just dropped that hardest hit in the liquor. He had just got that big deal with Universal. And we went and opened up for him at the Sun Valley Ranch in Victoria, Texas. So after we got off stage, right before Pokey got on, you know, the whole SUC team was there. Right before Pokey got on stage, they had a freestyle contest. And all my boys, you know, all my shut them down boys were like, man, get in it. They're telling me to get in it. I didn't want to get in it. They're telling me to get in it. So I said, man, all right, y'all want me to get in, I'll get in it. So I got in it. And I asked the DJ, what beats do you have? He started playing some instrumentals in the headphones. And then I heard the Southside beat. I said, all right, give me that little kicky Southside. So, bro, man, I ran that freestyle contest. I destroyed that dude. And they still tried to make it seem like he had a competition. So they made us do it twice. But I was clearly the winner. And I destroyed them again. And they didn't have no choice but to give me the crown, right? I won the freestyle contest. But this is doing his back word. He said, so there was a $500 reward I was supposed to win. He said, man, bro, we can't give you the reward, man. You're a professional, bro. You're a rapper. You just got off the stage. So they pulled a check on me at the end. I really wasn't tripping because I didn't want to get in it anyway, but I was just like, all right, it's cool. You know, I still won, you know what I mean? But yeah, man, I had that little right there that I wanted to share with y'all. And also, man, I want to give a shout-out, man. I'm going to shout-out, man, to my little cousin Buddha, man, and Lil Mikey, man. They both passed away last year, man, around this same time. They both took Xanax, man. You know, they had them fake fresh pills, man. So I just want to raise awareness on that, man. That just, man, y'all ain't gotta be doing that fake stuff out there, man. There's better ways to cope with problems out there. Whatever y'all dealing with, man. I lost a cousin, man, and I lost a good friend in Little Mikey, man. You know, so shout out to them boys in Grand Ole Park, Second Ward, my second home. Y'all know what's up, man.
Ready? Well, shit, Bing. Hey, Bing. First, I want to say I appreciate your time, bro. I appreciate, you know, you giving us this time to have these conversations. And again, it's an honor to have you on here, bro. I'm gonna let Tex close this out.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Bing, man. We appreciate you, man, tapping in with us. You know, it's all love, hustle time, man. You've been rocking with us from the very jump. You know what I'm saying? You gave us some of our very, very first cosigns, you know, being able to talk with you a while back. So I'm glad to be able to talk with you again. And, you know, it's always love. Anything, you know, we could do on this side for you from Hustle Town, you know, anything you need, you already know. I'm a phone call away, brother.
Hey, bro. Appreciate that.
That's right, brother, man. Hey, well, we appreciate you, bro. We're pretty much wrapped up, man. But, man, I appreciate you. Just, yeah, man, hit me anything, brother. We got you, and I'll shoot this stuff over to you. That way you get the word as soon as it's done. Okay, my brother, we appreciate you.